Wednesday Night Live with Tracy. It's the Tracy Show. Woohoo! And so this is our fourth live, and I'm having so much fun, and people are like, what are you doing? And why are you doing this? And I just kind of fell into it. I did that first video, and then I did the chicken video, and then I did Liberty Pest Control last time. And so I'm just going to keep going because I keep running into interesting people. And so this last week, I ran into Michelle Bailey.
Hi.
And she is a very interesting person and has a very interesting story, a heartfelt story to tell us today. And so first I'll have Michelle introduce herself and tell us a little bit about you.
Okay. Well, first, thanks for having me. I'm really excited to be here. I'm very excited for your show. It's fabulous. So I'm Michelle Bailey, and I am a teacher. So I work in Dayton. Yay, go Broncos. And live in Hull, born, raised, lived there my whole life. So very excited to kind of share our story about our journey with my daughter with y'all tonight.
Yes, so tonight's topic is her daughter at age 3 had to have a heart transplant. Whoa, that is a big, big deal, right? And so I kind of wanted to have her on to talk about organ transplant, how important it is to be a donor, mm-hmm. and kind of share her story so that we would all know what does a family have to go through when this happens in the family. So let's just start out. First of all, this happened, what, 6 years ago?
Almost seven.
Almost seven years
ago. It'll be 7 months. 7 years, sorry.
7 years, that's okay. And so take us back to when this all started. When did you even have any type of glimmer that this was a problem?
Okay, thanks so much. So when I was pregnant with Lorelai, we didn't know that there were going to be any problems. And I tell people that that's a God thing. He knows that I'm a warrior, mm-hmm. and that that would not have been good or healthy. And so when she was born, she was born on the 23rd, mm-hmm. and on the 24th, my dad and my husband had gone to get us something to eat. Mom and I were in the room with her and, you know, dressing her up and doing all the cute things to do with babies, matching pajamas, the works. Mm-hmm. And I noticed that she was breathing funny, and I didn't really know what to call it, retracting, nasal flaring. Those are the terms. Okay. I know them now, but it just, her nose would go in and out, and her ribs, it looked like she'd been running a marathon. She would just huff and puff, and I thought, you know, that's kind of weird. So I asked my mom, you know, my first baby, I was like, do all babies breathe like this? And she was like, well, I don't know. And so let's ask the nurse. I call a little nurse, and the nurse comes down and she takes a look at her and she's like, oh, I'm sure everything's going to be just fine. She'll be just fine. And she wraps her up and runs down the hall pushing her.
And then you're like, oh my gosh, that doesn't seem very normal.
I look over at my mom and I was like, I think she just lied to us. So yeah. We walk down there, and right as we get there, there's a doctor and because he wanted her to go to the NICU. So she goes to the NICU that night. They thought she swallowed some meconium, mm-hmm. and they thought that she had a lung infection. So the doctor's like, oh, it's a lung infection. We've got this. We're in a big hospital, and this, you know, no problems. And so the next day, they called in somebody to do an ultrasound. Over the night, they had to intubate her because she just wasn't breathing well on her own. And so they do an ultrasound, and you know, the little screen's only like this big, it's like a computer.
Were you in there?
Yes, okay. So my husband and I were both in the room. The night before, they sent me back to my room with a sleeping pill, and my husband stayed up with her all night in the NICU, and so he was there when they intubated her and all the things. So when I get up the next morning and get in there, they were just about to start. So the guy is hiding behind his little screen. Mm. He won't make eye contact with us. And so at this point, my husband's exhausted. He's trying to take a nap, and I'm just
like, wake up.
Wake up. And he's like, yeah. What is it? And I was like, something's not okay. Something's not okay. And so the guy doing the ultrasound walks over to talk to the doctor. Well, first he said something to the nurse, and she just goes and looks at him and, like, runs out of the room. Mm-hmm. So then the nurse and the doctor come back together, and the guy that was doing the ultrasound tech walks over, and he's telling him something, and the doctor's just looking like, I don't want to have to go talk to those parents. And she says something to the nurse, and the way their ICU was set up, it was all glass. So you can see her take off in a full sprint down the hall. And then she comes back, like, half a minute later with some medicine, and she showed it to the doctor, and then she went and hung it. What I didn't know at the time is that medicine is one that has to be checked by a second person. So the doctor actually made the second check on it. They didn't even have time to have somebody else verify it. They went and hung the bag and started the medicine. And so the doctor came over to explain to us that Lorelai actually had a CHD, or a congenital heart defect. We had no clue while I was pregnant. 1 in 100 babies are actually born with a congenital heart defect each year.
Wow, I didn't know it was that common.
Yes, ma'am. It's actually a lot more common. If you read the statistics for it, it's actually 1 in 100 is how many babies are born with it, and more children die of heart disease each year than all childhood cancers put together.
Wow.
But it's something that people don't talk about as much, and there's not, you know, as many campaigns for it.
Right.
A lot of people also think that if your baby's born with a heart defect, you did something wrong, because babies are supposed to be born with healthy hearts. And so, you know, that's kind of another thing that we've had to kind of face is, oh, well, what did you take to make her like that?
Oh, no. People actually ask you that?
Yes.
You are
people
kidding.
Will ask you anything.
People, do yes. not ask mean, dumb questions. Okay.
I concur. So, yes. And so for us, we finally found out that she had a mutation on one of her genes in early growth inside the womb, and that's actually what caused her heart defect. And so when she was born, she had two defects. And so one was coarctation of the aorta. So your aorta is what supplies your blood all through your body, to your brain, all the way through
your
body.
The main
yes.
artery, I guess.
Yes, okay. Ma'am. And so it splits off, and so hers was kinked like a water hose. So when you think about it, you kink a water hose, water can't get past,
That's a problem.
That's a problem, especially when it's your blood flow.
Yes.
So her blood flow to her brain was always very good. We're very, very blessed. But to her legs, that's where they were having the issues. And so then she had coarctation of the aorta, and then she also had something called Swiss cheese VSDs. So she had over 100 pinholes in her heart. So your heart has four chambers. You have two upper and two lower. And between the top two chambers, she had one pretty good size hole, but between these, she had over 100 holes. Just so.
So it wasn't leaking out of the heart, it was leaking into the different chambers.
Exactly.
Okay.
So one side of your heart takes your oxygenated blood and brings it all the way to your body. But the other side of your heart gets the oxygen from your lungs. And so what would happen is you have blood that's oxygenated and blood that's not. And it would mix together instead of going where it was supposed to.
And that's why she was having trouble breathing?
Yes.
Okay.
So she had unoxygenated blood that was trying to go through her body, but it wasn't getting far because of the coarctation.
Mm-hmm.
And then she had oxygenated blood that had already gone through the lungs, but it was back in line a second time for no reason. And so it was just adding flow to the lungs. And so she was actually transferred to another hospital. So we started off at Memorial Hermann in Memorial City. That's where she was born.
Okay.
Wonderful hospital, wonderful doctors.
Right.
And they transferred us to Memorial Hermann downtown.
Okay.
And to the children's side. And once again, it was a God thing. If I would have known ahead of time, I would have sent her to Texas Children, which is where she is now. But she was actually, I won't say misdiagnosed, but they didn't figure out exactly what she had until she was two.
Oh, wow.
Because what she has is very rare. And so.
So they didn't know the two things that you just told
us
about?
They knew the two things.
Okay, but there's more to this.
There's another one.
Okay, what's the next one?
So she also had restrictive cardiomyopathy. And so with restrictive cardiomyopathy, your heart can't relax. So it's a muscle, and it should pump and relax. But hers was just pumping, so it was like a little bodybuilder, so it just kept getting bigger and bigger bigger. And the muscles of it were hard, where some of your muscles are actually supposed to be soft. Tissues in your heart, hers were very hard.
So that's why they say an enlarged heart is not good.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And okay. So hers was just working way too hard, and so it wasn't going to be able to continue to do that. And so when we first got to the hospital, she was about 2 days old when we got to Hermann, and they told us that she needs to have at least one of the conditions fixed. So the coarctation had to be fixed. Has to be fixed through surgery. It's the only thing that you can do. And so we had an amazing doctor that day who we were in the Ronald McDonald House.
Yeah.
So I don't know if you know about the Ronald McDonald amazing foundation, and so they have either houses or actually rooms in the hospital for parents whose kids are very, very, very sick. Mm-hmm. And so we were able to stay in one of the Ronald McDonald rooms, my husband and I, there in the hospital with her, so that we could be there because we couldn't stay in the ICU. It's an amazing organization.
That is great.
And so they, we were in one of the rooms, and the doctor comes in there, and there's not much in the rooms. You don't need much in the room. Like, your kid's in the hospital, you're not on vacation.
Yeah, exactly.
So there's a bed and a TV and maybe two little chairs. And so my husband and I were sitting in the bed, and our parents were in there with us. And this doctor comes and crawls up in the bed and sits between us.
Oh my gosh.
And she gets out her little notebook and she draws a picture of what a typical heart should look like. And then she draws a picture of Lorelai's heart.
Right.
And every term that she was saying, coarctation and VSDs and ASDs and just, I was
you didn't know anything yet.
I taught eighth grade science. I still didn't know what she was saying. It was a foreign language.
Yes.
And so we kept, she would write those terms down so that we could look them up later, which she also advises, don't ever look it up.
Right, I bet, because it'll scare you too much.
Yes. Yeah. Good decision. Right. Listen to the doctors when they
say
that. Exactly. And so we went on, and the surgeons came in and decided to wait a couple of days. So she was actually 13 days old when she had her first heart surgery.
That is crazy. That is just crazy.
Yes.
A little bit. How many did she weigh when she was born?
She was actually 7 pounds, 15.6 ounces. So she was almost 8 pounds. But at any point in your life, your heart should be about the size of your fist.
Yeah.
So think about a 13-year-old.
Yeah.
Baby.
I mean, that is just. And they're doing basically microsurgery.
Yes.
On this little heart.
Yes.
And so that surgery was to repair
the coarctation.
And that means again.
The kink, the water.
Oh, the kink. Okay. Mm-hmm. So then more blood could get to the heart by fixing that.
Yes.
Okay.
So what they actually did.
They fixed the aorta then.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. So they went in, and where it was kinked, they actually cut off both sides of the kink, mm-hmm. and then sewed it back together. But the problem with that particular surgery is that the scar tissue, it's eventually going to stretch. So we would have to go in and balloon it a couple of times, mm-hmm. Before the transplant.
Yes.
And so at the time, they kind of said, we think kids have this surgery all the time. We think she's going to be fine. In a couple of months, she'll be home. She'll be playing. She'll be growing. It'll be, mm-hmm. she'll be like every other kid. And most of the time, that's what happens. But because she also had restrictive cardiomyopathy, that's not what happened for us. So she was intubated, and we kept trying to take the tube out so that she could breathe on her own.
Right.
And we would do all of the trials, and she would do so good and so good. And for whatever reason, she would crash, basically.
Right.
And so by this point, she was 2 months old when she got a trach and a G button. And so, we were right along in that area. And at this point, we couldn't let her wake up because she would start pulling at stuff. And, she just had a lot going on. And so I remember right before we made the decision to intubate her, we really thought she was going to do it. We had done trials for 48 hours. She breathed through them, no problem.
Yeah.
We thought, okay, this is it. And so I'm sitting at her bedside, and I didn't get to hold her from the time she had her first surgery until she was 2.5 months old.
Are you kidding me?
So,
my gosh.
When
wow.
she came out of surgery, they don't have a dedicated ICU, so she went to the NICU, mm-hmm. The PICU, so the children's. So she wasn't in neonatal, she was in children's.
Pediatric ICU, is that what PICU is? Okay.
So she was in the PICU, and so you could have kids all the way up to age 18 in there.
Right.
So they have a rule that says you couldn't, or they did at the time, I don't know what it is now, that you couldn't hold an intubated child, because how do you decide
which child children can be?
Exactly, and how do you fairly make that decision in that call, because age or weight or so.
Yeah, but it's important for those children to have
that bond.
That bond, and they've done studies about that. You can't just leave a child in a crib.
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
Exactly.
So
we were there every day, holding her hands.
Okay, good.
Rubbing
her still
head.
Touch her. You could
yeah,
still.
Yeah.
Okay,
so we
good.
Were still there with her, and so she and every once a day, I got to hold her straight up while they changed her bed, and it was like the most magical thing. I'd be like,
oh my god,
trying to get in under them, and so. But, you'd hold her up. And so finally, this one time, this trial, after 48 hours, they were like, okay, well, we're going to let you hold her. And I was like,
yeah.
So I'm sitting. sitting there and they hand her to me, and she's never really been held since she was 13 days old, and her bed didn't move. She didn't like the feeling of it or anything, so she was like, just kind of like,
wait, what's going on here?
Don't like this. So I'm holding her, and the nurse is at the nursing station, like right behind me. And she says, how does it feel to hold her? And I was like, oh my goodness, it's so great. I can't believe it. And I turn around, and she was turned blue.
Oh my gosh.
And so I start screaming for the nurse. I was like, oh, so it's not okay. And she collapsed along the way.
Oh my gosh.
And so, you know, of course, human nature, I'm convinced it's my fault. I somehow made her collapse the lung.
No.
And
no.
So the doctor has to come in and be like, you can't, like, that's impossible. Like,
there's no way that could happen.
It happened to happen. And, you know, still, the mommy in you is just like, well,
yeah,
it happened while I was holding her. And so then we started talking about tracheal. And so she ended up with a trach. She was on a ventilator. And nobody knew exactly what it was. Like, they would just call them episodes, and about once a day, she would just kind of stop breathing over the vent. So the ventilator was still breathing for her, but we'd have to like adjust the volume and push some buttons, and like it was a whole routine. We were very well trained about the hospital to know what to do.
So you're still at the hospital?
Yes. So you're still at the hospital.
This is how many months in?
2 months. So at 3 months, we transferred from the ICU to a different hospital. So the ICU, the doctors that are in the ICU aren't the same doctors that see you when you're on the floor. So they kind of had the decision of whether they wanted to leave us at that hospital where you have people who come in because they're sick, or if they wanted to send us to more of a growing hospital.
Right.
And so they decided, well, they gave us a choice, but their input was, and we went with that, is that they wanted us to go to somewhere called Healthbridge Children's Hospital.
Okay.
And I had never really seen many miracles in my life until I stepped on those grounds.
Really?
The things you see there are amazing.
Just, and is that here in Houston too?
It is. It's in Houston. And so Healthbridge Children's Hospital, we went in there, and then we were there until she turned almost 6 months old.
Oh my gosh. And okay, so she's there for 6 months. So daily life for you, y'all, are you both there the whole time, or did your husband have to go back to work, or how did all that work?
At some point, my husband did have to go back to work. I was working for a school district at the time, and was like, I'm sorry,
this way it's got to be, and that's what any mother would do that.
They were amazing. I mean, just very supportive. We understand what we do. Just, they were great about it.
Wonderful.
And so, thank you to all those people at Hardin ISD at the time. Thank you for being so good to me.
Yes.
And so, then we went on to the hospital. So, I lived in the hospital. And in fact, I tell people a story that the first time we left the hospital, my husband's grandpa had passed away right after Laurel, I was born. And I loved that man. Amazing, amazing man. And so, we were at his funeral, and we were just getting ready to go to graveside, and they get a call from the doctor, and they're like, hey, everything's fine now, which means at some point it wasn't.
Yeah.
And Lorelai's stable now, which means that my child who's less than 13 days old wasn't stable at some point today. But she went into heart failure.
Oh my gosh.
I'm like, how is everything okay when my kid's in heart failure? Like, you know, so we make a very quick trip back to Houston, and then I just didn't leave the hospital for anything.
And, you have a huge family.
A huge, amazing, supportive family. They were there for us all the time. And so the way that hospital is set up, we were in pods. So that means that there's more than one baby in each room. So when we went into the room, there were three other babies already in the room. And Lorelai was 7 pounds, 15.6 ounces, and she outweighed all three of those babies put together.
Oh my gosh, you're kidding me.
And so
we had preemies in there.
We had preemies. Tiny preemies who were doing very well, but they needed to stay well. And so we kind of had, everybody that was in that room kind of had the same mentality that anybody we let in, if they go home and didn't realize they had shelter, or didn't realize they had a cold, or didn't realize
it would not be good.
It wouldn't be good for our babies. And so we made the call as our family to only let parents, grandparents, great-grandparents, and just to limit Not only our baby's exposure, but the exposure for those other three babies.
Right.
I mean, one of the little babies wore her mom's wedding ring for a bracelet.
Oh my gosh.
She was 4 months old at the time.
Oh my gosh.
So,
Well, and for your health too, because you're stressed out.
Yes.
And you can't afford to get sick through all this. So, that's a good call.
Thank you. It was a hard decision to make, but, you you know, we ended up having to make a lot of those. Gosh. And so,
okay, you know, so you're at the Health Springs? So
Health Ridge.
Health Ridge.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're there for how long?
So we were there until she was, so she would have, at the 23rd, mm-hmm. so 2 days before Christmas, she would have turned 6 months old, and we came home on the 21st.
Okay.
So she was right at 6 months old.
Did you know about problem number three at that point?
We did not. We knew something wasn't right, but nobody could quite put their finger on what it was and why she couldn't be. They told us that she had a floppy airway, mm-hmm. and so that she would eventually just grow out of the floppy airway, that the cartilages in her airway would do what they need to eventually.
And multiple doctors have seen her at this point.
Yes, multiple
and
doctors.
So it's just one of those things you probably have to rule out a lot of stuff before you figure it out.
It definitely is. And like I said, her condition is very rare, restrictive cardiomyopathy. But then for it to manifest with other complications, mm-hmm. typically with a restrictive kid, you find it when they code.
Okay.
And so.
But they thought, oh, this is because of all these other things.
Yes.
And so and we're not looking for that third thing.
And her heart wasn't doing exactly what a textbook restrictive heart should do.
Right.
And so we'd been home, things were, you know, going good. She was growing, she was getting bigger, we're very, very blessed. But by the time we got transplant, we had spent as many nights in the hospital as we had at home. So, you know, we were kind of back
so
in
things
and
were happening, and you'd have to go and take care of these episodes that would happen.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
And so when she was two, she got put in the hospital for about 30 days. And when we went in, anytime she was in heart distress or heart failure, it looked like it was her lungs.
Mm-hmm.
And so we were in there 30 days, and the cardiologist and the pulmonologist are saying, it's not my organ, it's your organ, it's not your organ, it's not, because.
Yeah, they couldn't figure it out.
They couldn't figure it out, and hers just didn't follow the rules.
Right.
Wasn't.
She's special.
She is. Yes, ma'am. Very.
Special little girl.
And so the doctors kind of, you know, went in and so we had one pulmonologist and, you know, he was very supportive of me and, mm-hmm. and him and I sat down one day and he's like, you know, what's your mom got saying? And I was like, I think it's her heart. And he said, I think you're right.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, well, what do I do? And he said, give me one more chance mm-hmm. to talk to him. And if they don't listen to what I have to say, then we'll schedule a meeting with, you know, you and patient care advocates and everybody.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, okay, so they called me the next day. And they were like, because at this point, I was going to work. So I was teaching school by this point.
Gosh.
And so I was driving back and forth to the hospital every day. And so they said, you know, I was at school and they called me. They said, we're going to do a heart cath. And we actually are going to do it today. And I'm like, you're going to do what? And so.
And that's got a little risk to it, doesn't it?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. So a heart cath, you know, they're going to go in through your groin mm-hmm. And then go up into the heart. And so, you know, husband and I were both home. We're making a trip up there.
Yeah.
And we had heard whispers from one doctor mm-hmm. who had always said, this is restrictive, this is restrictive. And nobody else kind of agreed because she was walking. And she was like,
right.
I mean, just the things that she could do. She knew sign language. She was talking. She's amazing kid, and talking
right.
over a trach is an amazing feat for a baby that age. Like
she's very smart, I hear. A very smart kid.
She is very smart. Yes, yes. Ma'am. She's quick. She's
mm-hmm.
a very quick person, and so she could do all these things. And so you know, all the other doctors are saying it's not this. Well, our one doctor comes in and he says, you know, we're going to do heart cath and I'll say, listen, if she needs a transplant. Don't tell us about it. Because my grandmother was at every single cath with us, and she, you know, was in her 80s.
Mm-hmm.
My niece was at caths with us, and you know, she was maybe 12.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's not something I wanted them to have to process in that moment. And so the doctor comes in, and you know, we've got everybody, the whole family, got just so much support. So we've got a lot of people, and the doctor comes in. And as soon as he like walks through the doors, he very quietly tells my husband and myself, I'll talk to you at bedtime. And so we're like, okay. So we're sitting there, and this is a man who one night the coffee machine stopped working at the hospital. So he went home and read the entire manual.
Oh my gosh.
And came to work the next day and fixed the coffee machine. Not because it was his job, but because it was broken and it needed to be done. And he could do it.
Oh my gosh.
At one point in time, it had been about 4 months since we had seen him. Mm-hmm. And like, I mean, I know my child's not his only patient. And yeah. I'm walking down the hall and he's like, hey, why are you in the hospital? I was like, oh, we just got admitted a few minutes ago. And he's like, okay, I'll be up there in a few minutes. And so he starts asking me questions and I'm answering them. He knew what food that she was in her G-tube and like the dose of it and like how often, like
all these details.
Brilliant man.
Yes.
This man is just photographic memory. Brilliant. Right. Absolute brilliant man. His name's Dr. Balaguru. It's really good. And so we meet downstairs with Dr. Balaguru and he comes in and he starts saying, well, I don't know what the exact numbers are. And that was the first thing that I was like, this man, he knows the numbers. There's no way he doesn't know the numbers.
Right.
He doesn't want to tell us the numbers.
Right.
Because I asked him that.
Yeah.
And so he goes on and on, and he's like, she's good, she's stable, everything. You know, we have some more things to look into. And so the whole thing was like,
oh. Oh, because everybody's still in there. Okay.
Everybody's still in there.
Oh,
so
okay.
Everybody thinks,
okay.
Oh, you know.
We'll be okay.
Everything's fine. And
yeah.
So everybody kind of disperses, and Daniel and I are just real quiet because we're like, you know, we still don't know what we're about to get told. And we get to the bedside, and he's got tears in his eyes. Mm-hmm. He's like, she needs a transplant. He said, I called doctors in New Zealand, asked them if there was anything they could do.
Mm-hmm.
They told me to pull the labs and Mr. for a transplant. Mm-hmm. I called Phoenix, I called Pennsylvania, like every heart doctor he knew that thought that maybe they could tell him something different.
Yeah.
Because in the movies, people get a heart transplant, and it's like, oh, yay, look at them, they're perfect now, life is great. And it is not, that's not what it's like in real life.
Right.
And it's amazing, because my child would not be alive today mm-hmm. if it wasn't for our donor and our donor's family.
Right.
But she has to take meds, mm-hmm. and it's a process.
Right.
It's a journey.
Mm-hmm.
And so,
It's serious. It's one of the most serious. It's so serious.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so it's always the last resort. And even leaving that hospital, because they don't do heart transplants there, so they sent us to Texas Children. And even when we got to Texas Children, it wasn't, they said you need a heart transplant, you probably do. It was we're going to run all of our own tests.
Right.
And
they
so
want to make
was,
sure.
Exactly, which, you know.
Which makes sense.
Exactly.
That's kind of a big deal.
It's a big deal.
Yeah.
And so she was 2 when we transferred to Texas Children, and she was actually 3 when she was listed. So.
Okay, so they tell you need the transplant. And then how long between then and you, well, tell me, they put you on a list. How does that work? You get on the list, and then tell us how that, just keep going.
Okay. So with Marla being so young, mm-hmm. we actually, so they told us at one point, so they kind of said, she needs a transplant, but we're not listing her just yet. Because once she has a transplant, she can never get another lab vaccine. And so at this point, she hadn't had any of her vaccines because she was too little.
Mm-hmm.
And so we need her to have some vaccines before we can list her. So we're going to give her vaccines, and then we're going to try to get her on the list. So we had a six weeks window.
Okay.
We gave vaccines. We're hoping they're going to take as best they can.
Right.
But we can't give you a transplant because we shut down your immune system.
Right.
And all those live vaccines.
Right.
Something can happen.
Right.
And so if you have a healthy immune system, that's how vaccines work. Your body goes, oh, hey, let me fight you.
Right.
And then you build up tolerance and antibodies and immunity to it. So since Lorelai can never have another live vaccine, we require everyone else to have vaccines because that's the only way she's protected.
That is an important topic.
Yes, ma'am.
So let's repeat that. Because we have children who can never have vaccines, it's important for the rest of us to have vaccines so that we can have the herd immunity
mm-hmm.
and so that somebody doesn't come in contact with this child mm-hmm. and give her whatever it is.
Yes.
Polio,
measles.
Measles.
Even chicken pox. You know, I got chicken pox when I was a kid and I scratched for a week and I was fine. Chicken pox is one of the deadliest things to heart transplant.
Oh my gosh, I didn't know that.
Because they don't just get on you. It is a virus.
Right.
And that virus will attack things that it's not supposed to. And it's very deadly. If she was going to public school and a child in her classroom
mm-hmm.
had chicken pox, she would be hospitalized for 21 days, no questions asked, so that they could watch her.
Oh my gosh.
If a child in the class's brother or sister got it, it's automatic 14 days hospitalization. And so it's a very serious serious thing for us. Like, you know, it's
it's life and death.
It is. It's life and death for her. And I would immunize my child if I could.
Yeah, exactly.
But I can't. And so it is important because when a kid does get one of those things because they're not immunized, they're going to the hospital.
Right.
And that's where my kid is.
Right.
Because she got pneumonia or she got whatever.
Right.
And
right.
she's now in the same room as she or the room next door. And she can't write that.
Well, and plus you just don't want your kid to have to go through whooping cough. If you go on YouTube and look up whooping cough, it is horrible.
Yes.
Please, please, please vaccinate.
Yes.
Please. Okay. I'm on a little soapbox there because I'm big on that too.
Yes.
Okay, so now you're kind of waiting, right?
Yes. So we spent those 6 weeks, and you know, those 6 weeks I look back on them. I think we took 4 vacations. We just lived.
That's smart.
In those 6 weeks, we went, you know what? We know we have 6 weeks, and we don't know what we have after that.
Right.
For us, we knew that at that point she needs a new heart.
Yeah.
She had a trach, and at that point, Texas Children hadn't accepted a lot of kids to get a heart transplant with a trach because trachs are a port of infection. And so we know that when you get a heart, you don't have an immunity. And so.
Yeah.
So there's a very high risk of infection. And so we knew that that was kind of a strike against us. And then when you get a transplant, they have to match your antibodies. So your donor's antibodies have to match your antibodies. So it's more than just your blood type. They have to be the same blood type, the same BMI, so body mass index. So it's going to be someone the same size, same weight. But then their blood types actually have to match. And then the antibodies. With everything Lorelai had been through, she'd been through multiple surgeries. She'd been through, because there was another surgery, heart surgery, in between those two that we didn't even talk about. But she'd been through a lot at this point. I remember the first surgery that she had, there was somebody else in there, and they're like, oh, I don't know how many surgeries my kid has had. And I thought, how in the world? And now I'm up here. I definitely can't count them on, you know,
oh my gosh,
hands.
Wow.
Maybe hands and toes, but it's been a lot. If you count cats and just procedures. And so she'd been through a lot. And anytime you do those things, or if you have blood products, it increases your chance to have more antibodies anytime you're exposed to things. And so at the time, you know, we went in and we were told, you're going to need a transplant. I was like, well, what do we pray for? Like, I want specifics to tell my family exactly what we're praying for. And so we had an amazing coordinator at the time. She said, we need our antibodies to be less than 5. She said, it's not impossible if they're over 5, but it's harder.
Right.
So we need them to be less than 5. And she said, we need insurance to be in our favor. And so insurance, almost immediately we got that answer. Well, the antibodies take a little bit longer to come back.
Yeah.
And so we were in Toys R Us when we got the phone call. And so I'm in Toys R Us, and I've got, you know, my baby, and my mom's with me, and my husband. And Corey calls, and she's like, Michelle, they're back. And I'm like, oh, please God, please God. They're
zero. Oh. That's
absolutely
a good thing.
Zero. It was like, she's like, there's zero. I looked at it twice. There's zero. So I'm screaming and running around Toys R Us and getting all of the looks because I look like a crazy.
Right.
So I tell my mom and my husband, as I'm screaming, it's zero. There's zero. There's zero. And so now they're screaming and crying, and we're all hysterical in Toys R Us. It was good times.
Yeah, that's a good thing.
Good times, you know.
So you do get some good news along the way here.
Yes, definitely. Yeah. And so, and it was, you know, once again, I feel like that part was just God saying, I've got this. Like, remember, I am God, and I am in control, and I've got this. Like,
right. Don't worry.
And so, and that to me was just like a,
yeah.
I got you.
Good.
And so, anyways, at that point, we get listed.
Mm-hmm.
So we were listed on July 1st, and we waited for 20 days.
That's unbelievable. That's another God thing.
It is a God thing, yes, ma'am. So it was 20 days, and so we were all actually at my aunt's house. The whole family's down. I had a cousin. He's in the Army, so he was down, and we were all visiting him. And so we're at my aunt's house, and you know, it had only been 20 days.
Like, right. So you're not expecting us, because you hear, like on TV, it's years,
and it can be.
And it probably maybe will.
And it definitely can be if your antibodies are higher. Just there's so many factors. Your status, we were a 1A status, but we got to be at home, which is also something that's not as common, but because mm-hmm. she had a ventilator, she automatically got on the 1A. And also, her heart was so bad that it was damaging her lungs. And right. if it would have taken much longer, we would have needed a heart and double lungs. Mm-hmm. And so,
So they put her,
on this 1A, yeah. 1A status.
Is that the highest?
That's the highest status.
Oh, okay. So,
So that's the highest status.
Yeah.
And so I sat on the couch, and you know sometimes when you've got baggy pockets, like your phone will fall off?
Yeah.
Well, the couch reclined, and there went my phone, straight underneath the couch.
Oh, no.
And I'm like, yeah, I'll get it later, until it rings. And so I'm like, oh. And so I'm trying to get under the couch and get it, and my cousin, who was in the Army, had had surgery on his foot.
Yeah.
And so he's down there trying to help me, and we're awkwardly trying to dig under the couch. And as soon as I pull it out and look at it, it says unavailable. And so that's what the hospital was going to come up as, and I'm like, oh, no. My husband's not there. He had gone to get the rice for the gumbo, and I was freaking out. So I was like, you know, what do I do? And so my aunt's like, it's okay. They'll call back. It's hospital, they'll call back. So I'm like, okay. Well, I'm going to fix me some tea. So I set my phone down, and as soon as I did it, it rings again. And so I pick it up, and it's unavailable. And then it's like, you know, like your fingers trembling so bad. You can't even really answer. And so I push the button, and it's Corey again, our wonderful coordinator that we had at the time. She says, hey, Michelle, this is Corey. Uh-huh. Isn't it weird for me to call you on a Saturday? And I'm like, yes, yes. And she's like, how would you like to come to Houston and get a heart? And I just.
Yeah, I bet.
You know, just start bawling and squalling. And then my cheek hits the button and hangs up on her. And I can't call her back. And so here I am, just like, oh, my goodness. But so, you know, we make the trip and we get there. And just, it's all a funny story. The coordinator, who had actually been doing it for years, like when we heard her version of the story too, was super funny because she'd been doing this for years, but this was her baby too.
Oh, yeah.
And she was at the mall shopping and she couldn't find her car. She's like, I gotta find my car.
Oh,
and
no.
So, like, we were all like just
freaking out.
It was 20 days.
Yeah. You just don't expect it.
You don't. And so, you know, so now we're like driving to the hospital with a 3-year-old and trying to explain to her why everybody's crying and everybody's laughing and everybody's going to the hospital, why she's going to the hospital, because she knows she's not sick. And you know, that was a hard time to you know, try to tell her that you know, you're gonna get a new heart. And, mm-hmm. you know, but she'll be 10 in a few days.
That's amazing.
Yes, ma'am, we're so blessed. And she actually recently started asking about her donor.
Really?
And so
what do you say when the child asks about the donor?
You know, it was hard at first, like, to think, you know, what am I going to say? What am I going to say? And so it's something that I've prayed about and asked for prayers for, and, you know, God just gave me the words when it was time. And so she had recently gone to an event where there was both a donor and the recipient there. Mm-hmm. And so we went to a kidney anniversary party and amazing friends and he had gotten a kidney and his donor was there. And so she got to meet them and kind of like, she was, you know, taking it all in. And you could just see the wheels just turning. Mm-hmm. And so she says, a couple weeks later, Mom, I think I want to meet my donor. Mm-hmm. And, you know, just like, and so we talked about a kidney and what a kidney does. Mm-hmm. And then we talked about a heart. Think that you could live without your heart? And she thought about it and she says, no. And I said, okay, so we can't meet your donor until we get to heaven.
Right.
So, but until then, you know, we can reach out to their family and mommy will help you write that letter. So a lot of people also don't know that on the recipient side, we're not allowed to write a letter until 1 year. Mm-hmm. They won't send it. We can write all the letters that we want, but they will not send it to the 1 year. And so, and even at the 1 year
mark, to let them process, that other family.
To let them have their time to process. Mm-hmm. And to also, because early in transplant, it's rocky.
Right.
You know, and so.
Yeah, because, back up, I mean, just because, what I'm thinking, if you tell me my daughter's going to have a transplant, I'm very happy, but I'm still scared to death.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And so you had to go through that surgery, probably still scared to death, making sure everything comes out okay. And then there's the chance of what, rejection,
organ just total failure. Mm-hmm. There's the chance that the organ just doesn't wake up. Like, sometimes they just don't accept the donated heart at all. And so for us, we actually, she came out of the transplant in heart failure, which is not what you want at all. She was actually on a BiPAP machine. The heart that they accepted for her was a little bit on the smaller BMI range. Mm-hmm. And so there's they actually made sure that there was an available machine mm-hmm. in the hospital to put her on BiPAP if she needed help. Because they knew that that was a possibility. And after the transplant, they're like, you know, we'll know in 48 hours. And, you know, so she actually came out of transplant and she wasn't closed all the way. And so what that means is that machine was actually sewed into her heart.
Wow.
And so this wasn't completely closed. And so she doesn't have an immune system.
And that's risk for infection.
Crazy risk for an infection. And then with BiPAP at that stage, stroke and heart attack. So there's a man with a flashlight staring at the tubes of the BiPAP machine with this little flashlight to make sure he didn't see a blood clot. And he did not leave, like, that chair for 48 hours.
Oh,
I never
my gosh. Wow.
I mean, just stared, just amazing. And he was so trusted that the doctors actually, like, called this particular man mm-hmm. in, and they were like, hey, we want you to do this. And mm-hmm. he was like, okay. Yeah. You know, just stepped right up and did it. And so after transplant, most transplants, they have them up walking by that night. Mm-hmm. I mean, they want you up, they want you moving, they want to start getting fluid out. Mm-hmm. But that wasn't our journey because
right.
Lorela doesn't do things by the rules. And so she came out in heart failure, and then her stomach wasn't waking up like mm-hmm. it should, and they mm-hmm. actually had to go and change. She has a G-tube, it's a feeding tube.
Okay.
And they actually had to change the G-tube for what's called a JG-tube. Mm-hmm. So it actually feeds two different parts of your stomach.
Okay.
And so because the upper part of her stomach wasn't accepting the food, mm-hmm. and so she was still not able to, like, let the lower parts of her stomach wake up, so she had to have another surgery change the JG tube. And then, so the donors, they don't
need to know.
They don't need to go through that.
No.
They just gave you the most precious gift, mm-hmm.
and they want it to work.
They want it to work, and they don't, like, I can't imagine, like, mm-hmm. having to go through those ups and downs with you as well.
No.
And so there are lots of reasons for the one-year mark. Mm-hmm. And so we, you know, did write our donors at the one-year mark. And we have not heard from our donors. Mm-hmm.
But they could reach out?
They could reach out at any time.
Okay.
You know, I don't want to write them mm-mm. at the anniversary of it.
No,
because, while that is an amazing time for us, that's when they lost their child. Mm-hmm. And so, and all we know about our donor is that he was two. Mm-hmm. That's all we know about him. She was three and he was two. We don't know what state, area, nothing. And in our letter to them, we were actually, you're not allowed to use your last name.
Okay.
You can't tell anything about your location or the hospital you're at. My daughter's name is Lorelai. If you Google Lorelai heart transplant, you'll
find
lots of information about my family.
I bet.
And we were actually told we weren't allowed to put her first name in the letter.
Wow.
And so, you know, so the family who gets that, mm-hmm. you know, that's all they see is just my daughter and mm-hmm. she, blah, blah, blah. And so, but that's the reason why those letters are very
generic.
Yeah.
But it's a big thank you.
It is, definitely. Yeah. And so, and they're actually read by our coordinators mm-hmm. and the coordinator on the other side to make sure that no information is
right. And to make sure it's appropriate and
yes.
that it'll be okay.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And so, and you know, that is another thing that is common in transplant is survivor's remorse. And so it's something that we see in the older patients. Mm-hmm. But when you have a three-year-old, she didn't get it then. And so that felt more on
the parents.
Myself and my husband. And mm-hmm. just, you know.
Feeling so bad for that other family.
Exactly. And spending all that time knowing that in order for our kid to live, somebody else's child wasn't going to. Mm-hmm. And, you know, just that thought on your mind, even though, you know, there's nothing you could do. And, you know, I'm going to go ahead and talk about the myth now that if your donor card has a little heart on it, that they won't do everything to save you. Guys, if you're a donor, great job. Thank you so much. I can't even, my child's alive because of the donor, so thank you. But the doctors are going to do everything they can to save you. They took an oath. They're going to do everything they can. And then if they can't, then they're going to give your family the chance to make that decision if they want to, you know, share that gift of life. And
so it's important for the family to know.
It is important for the family to know, definitely.
Yes. So if you have it on your driver's license, mm-hmm. make sure that your spouse or whoever would be making those decisions for you knows that you want to be an organ donor.
Yes.
So that they can help make that decision.
Yes.
You know, it's just very important. And you could save, oh, I don't remember how many lives they say, but it's a lot of lives.
It's a lot of lives, definitely. And so because so many things, like the lungs sometimes go to one person, sometimes they go to two. Mm-hmm. The heart, tissues, eyes, there's kidneys, liver, mm-hmm. and the liver can be split. And the kidneys, one, you know, sometimes somebody needs both of them, sometimes they just need one. And it's just, it's amazing what they do. And so many people in the United States die every day.
Right.
On a transplant list.
Yeah.
And, you know, a lot of it is just, there's not that knowledge out there about it. It's not that, you know, people are like, oh, I want my organs. It's just that
they don't think
people
about it.
Don't think about it. And if you've not had this discussion at all, mm-hmm. and then all of a sudden something terrible has happened to your loved one, especially when we're talking hearts.
Right.
Because of the, they have to be considered brain dead. And so mm-hmm. usually that's some type of traumatic accident.
Right.
So usually if you haven't talked about it, then all of a sudden people show up and they're like, you know, professional as they can be, but they've come to you at the worst possible time of your life.
Right.
And they start talking about this, and this is the first you've ever had the conversation, then it's got to be hard to say.
And they don't know what to do.
Yes, exactly. And they don't know what your wishes were.
Right.
And so, you know, for us,
just thankful.
We're so thankful. I mean, Lorelei couldn't walk across the house. Mm-hmm. She would have to, like, walk to the fireplace and sit and rest. And then walk to the couch and sit and rest and walk. She was 30. 3 year old shouldn't have to sit and rest.
No. So now she's 10 years old. Almost 10 years old.
Almost 10.
Okay.
She reminds me, Mom, I'll be in double digits next week. Thanks for that.
So what's the life of a transplant person afterwards? Like, what's a day? What's, I know you have to take a lot of medicine, right?
Yes. So, just like if you get a splinter, your body, you know, tries to push that splinter out because it knows, hey, that doesn't belong here. Mm-hmm. Her body will always know that that is not her original heart. And so just like your body, your immune system would try to attack that splinter, her immune system will try to attack the heart. And so to keep that from happening, she takes anti-rejection medicines. Mm-hmm. And so they do a great job of convincing her body that, hey, you don't want to attack this. So
right.
basically all it does, not all, but abridged version, mm-hmm. it makes your immune system lazy.
Okay.
So she does, which is wonderful a lot of time like this, right?
Right, exactly.
And so she doesn't have an immune system. So although her body goes, yeah, there's that heart that doesn't belong, we'll get it later.
Yeah.
It does the same thing anytime she's introduced to the flu or to a cold, pneumonia.
Yeah.
We get pneumonias a lot. And so...
And so she homeschooled?
She does homeschool, mm-hmm. yes. My mom, hi mom, is wonderful, and she homeschools her for me. It's not a decision that every transplant patient mm-hmm. makes, but it works best for us.
Right.
And so, and once again, I teach a public school teacher. Mm-hmm. I believe in public school. I think it's wonderful. But for her, mm-hmm. you know, it just...
Yeah, it makes sense.
We were admitted 8 times when we tried to go to school, and so we started in August. I pulled her out in February. And she was admitted 8 times during mm-hmm. that. And so every time she's admitted, you know, that's time that I'm at the hospital with her and, mm-hmm. you know, away from my job and just, you know, we risk her heart facing more rejection.
Right.
So in a typical day, she takes medicines. At this point, we're very blessed. She takes mm-hmm. 2 anti-rejection medicines. She takes just some regular over-the-counter medicines. Milk and magnesia is mm-hmm. one. So magnesium is something that transplant patients can't regulate mm-hmm. after a transplant, so they need magnesium. And then she takes a Flintstones vitamin.
There you go.
Vitamins.
Yeah.
And she takes some Lasix, so some fluid pills every day. And that's really it. After transplant, she was taking 31 doses in the morning.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, so we had a picture, and it's like a paper towel just full of meds of all various colors and sizes and shapes. And, you know, everything goes in her button. She doesn't have to taste anything. And so she is very happy about that. But
Can she eat normally too?
Yes.
Or just, okay.
So now she eats, she drinks anything that she wants by mouth.
Mm-hmm.
The G button is just for meds.
Okay.
And then
that's nice.
And it also sometimes can keep us out of the hospital. Because you know when you're sick and you don't want to drink.
Right.
Well, if you're sick and you don't want to drink, that's not good for anybody. Mm-hmm. But it's particularly not good for you to be a heart patient and to get too dry.
Right.
And so, and then we give a new Lasix to push even more fluid. So just, I can usually keep her out of the hospital if I can just put fluids in her. I can keep her from going to have to get it.
Right. Right.
So, yeah. So.
Well, I am so happy for you and your family.
Thank you.
That she's doing so well. And I know that your family just loves all of you, both of you, the whole family. And so you're so blessed and it's just wonderful. Now let me ask the producer. My producer over here, did I miss any questions?
You sure did.
Okay, what?
Professionals.
Oh, yes. Okay, so this has led to kind of a different professional change for her. So go ahead and tell us about that.
Yes, so I'm a teacher. Mm-hmm. I teach high school. I teach family and consumer science, which I love. So right now I'm teaching child development and child guidance, and those are my favorite types of classes to teach because you just get good kids, and I love the district in that. And so one of the things that I'm doing right now is actually going to be a counselor. So I'm going to be a school counselor.
Great.
Yes. And then once I finish being a school counselor, and after I retire, that's one of the things I want to do is to earn my LPC during that time and work with families who have either have been affected by heart transplants in some way, either donor families, recipient families, because you do have the survivor's remorse.
Right.
And then you have, there was a case with a teenager that was transplanted around the same time as my daughter, and just, he was overwhelmed by life, and, you know, he stopped taking his medicine. And for him, he was transplanted as a teenager, so he didn't have that, you know, Lorelai was transplanted at three. And
it was just a routine for her.
Yeah,
but
it's
for him, he
for
had
him.
To get used to it.
Exactly. And unfortunately,
he
didn't make it. It was too long without the meds. I want to be there for those families and just, you know, be able to, you know, be the, you know, for me, like, this has been a journey, and, you know, I'm able to say now that there was a time when I questioned God, not his existence,
right,
but why.
Why is this happening to
us? I was mad at him. Like,
sure.
I wouldn't tell him because it's God. But finally, when I was like, you know what? Like, this isn't fair. This isn't right.
They cannot even take
any
more of this.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know, God just kept showing up
and
just kept making antibodies over zero and putting us on a list for 20 days and just showing up in big and powerful ways and just blessing my relationship with my family and my marriage and just everything that, you know, our jobs, just blessing us and Lorelai just growing and with everything she's been through, her still having, you know, such good cognitive abilities and just
that's amazing.
It is a miracle.
It is a miracle.
With everything she's been through, for her to have just still such good memory in mind, and it's amazing.
Well, and you are so good at explaining all of this, and I think you're going to be an awesome advocate. You already
are
an awesome advocate, but you're going to be great at this new journey, and
I
think you're going to help a lot of families.
Aww.
I know you will. I really do. It's really, really good.
You know, God has just really blessed us, and that is something I would like to do, is just to help other families in this time, and to help those families who are considering organ donation, or you know, who are putting that in that spot, who, you know, something terrible has happened, and I'm so sorry for that loss, but for us, that gift gave us reason to celebrate, and you know, that her transplant day is hard for us, because I do think of that family, but I think of them all the time. I think of them, you know, on birthdays and holidays, and you know, just am so grateful for that brave decision that
right.
they made.
Right. So to wrap it up, what needs to happen is people need to vaccinate.
Yes.
They need to consider being a donor.
Yes.
And put it on your driver's license and tell your family.
Mm-hmm.
And just support people. Support
exactly.
people that are going through a really hard time.
Yes.
You know, it's tough. We have no idea
mm-hmm.
what people are going through. And that's kind of why I wanted to have you here. Like you hear, oh, she had a transplant. Well, you don't realize that is a big, long journey.
Yes.
And it's a lot of ups and downs. So I wanted people to know what it's all about.
Yes. And then she's still like, so we still go to CATS every mm-hmm. 6 months to a year. We're still, they test, they go in, they take little pieces of her heart, test mm-hmm. them for acute, which is short-term rejection, and then also long-term rejection. And so they're just running tests, and you know, they'll follow her forever.
Yeah.
So,
well, good. Well, we wish you all the luck.
Thank
and
you.
I know that God will still be with you.
Thank you, and thanks so much for having
yes,
me today.
Thank you.
And letting us share our story and our journey.
Great. Thank you, thank you.
Yay, thank
all
you.
All right, let me say one more thing. So for next week, I'm not sure what next week is. We have an idea of what next week is, but if you would like, if you know somebody interesting that I could interview, put them in the comments because I'll track them down and we'll try to get them on the show. All right. Thank you, everybody.
Bye, guys.